say, wilting all the time. I can't wait to see the summer. Baking pies, sexy mummy, small guitars, sugar daddy, lullabies, sleepy Yuki, the perfect place to be. We won't care about the winter, we won't care what the neighbors say, we'll sing all the time.
Welcome to Summer 6th. We are the Iranian American Bar Association, Northern California chapter. We are a nonprofit, all-volunteer organization. My name is Ali Asare. I'm on the board of directors of IABA NorCal and one of your co-hosts today.
And good evening. My name is Elika Vafai. I'm also on the board of IABA NorCal and your other co-host today.
Thank you for joining us for Summer 6, the final installment of our Summer 6 series. We're going to take a moment at the beginning to just reflect back. The Summer 6 series started with a very, very small idea at the beginning of the summer. We really just had two students who had lost their jobs because of COVID during their finals. And we felt so bad that we told them, we're gonna help you find alternate jobs, so you just focus on your finals and we'll do what we can to match you with alternate jobs. Well, when we started reaching out to the community asking for help, people were so kind, so giving, and it really shocked us. And we just, the idea sprouted from that small idea. We expanded the program, and thanks to generous support of community members, many of whom are with us today, including one of our speakers, Laura Stein, who graciously agreed to hire a lot of students who had lost their jobs this summer because of COVID. We were able to find 16 paid positions as a result of that program, which was incredible. In parallel to the jobs program, we wanted to create a training program just to make sure that everyone, even those who we weren't able to help, have a chance to keep growing this summer, and especially growing those skills that are so, so important, but are not really taught in law school or many other schools for that matter. Skills like leadership, like networking, like growth, like community building. And so that's how we started the Summer 6 program. Many of you have been with us for the journey from Summer 1. Summer 1 was about perspective and how things will be okay. It's very difficult, we understand, but with the community's help, we will pull through. Summer 2 was about community, how friends are so important to our community. Summer 3 was about focus, how to pick values and goals and how to achieve them once we've picked them. Summer 4 was about growth and how everything is learnable, leadership. Summer 5 was excellence, and we had an executive coach and other guests who talked about authentic personal branding and telling your story confidently. And so all of that has built up now to today, to Summer 6, which is about fulfillment and how we can use our careers as a vehicle to our fulfillment. So thank you so much for joining us throughout, and thank you for joining today's program, Summer 6.
Wonderful. And so, as Ali mentioned, today's theme is fulfillment. We have three wonderful guests who are role models in the legal career for how to build a fulfilling career.
We'll start with the introductions. Laura Stein is our first guest. Laura is general counsel and executive vice president of corporate affairs at the Clorox Company. Laura, would you mind quickly introducing yourself?
Hi, everybody. Thanks so much, Ali and Alika. I'm so glad to be here with everyone and really looking forward to this discussion. So as Ali said, I'm at Clorox and get to work with fantastic people like Ali. And we focus on really our reputation and ensuring the company always lives its core value of doing the right thing. So as somebody, I love international things. I speak a number of languages, love to travel. And then from a personal standpoint, I have two kids fully launched in San Francisco and a wonderful husband I met when I was in law school. And the good news, if there is any good news in these kind of unprecedented times, the silver lining is my kids have been back living with me. So life is good.
Great. Thank you. Next, we have Monica Kalaravarma, who's the Executive Director of the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights of the San Francisco Bay Area. Monica, if you could quickly introduce yourself, please. And I think you're on mute.
Yes. Thank you so much, Alika. Alika is also a fellow Lawyers Committee friend and colleague, so thank you for having me. I have been with the Lawyers Committee for about 3 years. We are one of the oldest civil rights institutions on the West Coast. We were formed after Dr. King and Bobby Kennedy were killed to be a bridge between the private bar and the civil rights movement. So for over 52 years, we have been committed to dismantling systems of oppression and racism, really on the forefront of the racial justice fight and imagining. Including the most recent uprisings. We also work on economic justice, which is intricately tied to to racial justice as well as immigrant rights. I also have children who are, if we're gonna have a fulfillment conversation, I can't keep them out. I have twin boys that are 8 and an 11-year-old daughter. And when I'm not working, I'm trying to decide if it's fulfilling, but I am now a homeschool teacher along with my husband. So. Yeah, that's also happening right now. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for being a teacher on top of everything else, Monica. And final guest, Abam Mambado. Abam is a writer, lawyer, founder of Mama Tuk Tuk, a media company that's putting incredible content out there. Abam, do you mind saying a few words about yourself?
Hi, and I'm really excited to be here, especially all the way from Singapore. It's great. I feel connected to home when I get to get on Zoom calls with everybody else in the US. I'm Abam Mambado, and I'm currently in between jobs. I just finished 9 fantastic years at GlaxoSmithKline, and starting September 1st, I'm joining Microsoft. So really just on a nice break in between and taking the time to think about things like fulfillment. I was born in Cameroon, migrated to the US when I was 16 years old, lived there all the way through 2016 when my company relocated into South Africa. And I lived there for a year and a half and then was moved to Singapore. And the whole way through, I've had my sidekick with me, my son who's now 10, Valen. And I'm a bit of a Jane of all trades, but I would say a mistress of maybe 3. I'm a writer, I'm a lawyer, and I love to speak on issues of inclusion and diversity, empowerment, and social justice. So I try to do all of those now, and I'm really looking forward to an amazing conversation. Thank you all for having me.
Hey, thank you so much for joining us and being in space today. So a little bit about the structure of today's program, following similar structures to the past Summer 6 series. We're going to do some interview questions, some Q&A with our incredible speakers. We'll have an opportunity also for Q&A from our participants today. And at the end, we are going to summarize key takeaways.
Thank you. So right before we start, though, we wanted to use the Summer 6 program also as an opportunity to support our awesome local artist communities. A lot of whom were affected by the pandemic. So as with each program, we have incredible live musicians to kind of play tunes throughout the program for us and lift our mood. So today we have Nina Han and Vita Yi, who are incredible violinists, and they actually are socially distancing playing violin for us today. While they're playing, a poll question is gonna show up on your screen. So if you don't mind quickly answering the poll question as well, it will help guide us through the rest of the program. Thank you so much for joining us, Nina and Vita, and please.
Thank you. Ali, so I wanted to introduce this piece before we play it because it's cool. If you see this piece of music here, it's actually called the Mozart Tabletop Duet or the Mozart Mirror Duet. And the reason it's...
Oh, sorry, Nina, you got cut off. It's called the Tabletop Duet.
Yes, okay. I think I'm back off of mute. And so it's called the Tabletop Duet because it is actually flippable. And so one person is playing it from one direction and the other person is playing from the other. So you can put it on a tabletop and play it this way. So that's what we're going to start with.
On behalf of everyone, I'm clapping. How cool is that? That is amazing. For all of our law students, what a better networking icebreaker than you can say, do you guys know about Tabletop Duet? What a great concept. Thank you, Nina and Vita. We'll get to hear more of your music. Let's get started. Super excited. Just to summarize the poll results, that we flashed a poll on the screen during the music, and the question was, what is fulfillment mean to you? And the great majority of people picked being happy in your career. Second response was being respected in your career. And third was to have a work-life balance. So on that note, Laura, I will start with you. What is fulfillment mean to you? And specifically, what does it mean in your legal career? And off mute.
Now I'm off mute. Hello. Hey, Nina, and that was so incredibly wonderful. Thank you to you and your partner. I love that. As I think about fulfillment in my legal career, it really ties to kind of, for me, fulfillment in life. And so, you know, maybe, Ali, I'll you speak from both a professional standpoint, but also a community and a personal standpoint. So, you know, as I think professionally, you know, I'm fulfilled when I'm doing awesome work, working with an amazing team, and for doing that work for a client who I really believe in their purpose. And so, you know, when I've got the combination of just really interesting work, a team that we have each other's backs and care about each other and try to make each other better, and then working for a client who we believe in what they do. That, for me, is just kind of foundational. And then also in fulfillment in my career, I want to continuously learn, continuously grow. There's so much to learn and grow. So, you know, being in a culture, in a place that just values kind of continuous improvement and constantly, you know, learning and getting better. And then, you know, kind of tied to that in the community point I made is it's really important to me in my professional life to be able to be involved in supporting the community. And as a lawyer, I feel incredibly strongly that, you know, I'm so fortunate, as we all are, as the law students you will be, to have the privilege of practicing law. We have a special role in society to help those who are underserved and need access to justice. And so I really think that in my professional career, it's been really important to me to be able to be involved in supporting and volunteering or doing pro bono work for organizations I love, primarily in the access to justice, diversity and inclusion, or rule of law areas is kind of where I put most of my energy. And it's, you know, feeling part of bringing about positive change and being part of, together with others, trying to make a positive difference and make things better. And then personally, for people who know me, you know, my family and my friends are kind of my source of inspiration, my source of strength. And so fulfillment to me is, you know, when I'm being a kind person, being from Minnesota, being kind is incredibly important to me. And people who are kind matter a lot to me. And then just trying to be bold and courageous and live up to being the kind of person that my family and friends are for me. So all of that fulfills me very much. And then Ali, did you want anything more? But I just was trying.
That's wonderful. We're unmuting ourselves as well. Thank you, Laura. I think one thing I've learned from you is how you kind of shattered that barrier between work and life. And that's how you even started your answer. You said it's fulfillment in everything and kind of not to think of it as this is my work that I don't like and this is my life that I like, but think about it as one organic whole that all ties into each other. And so thank you for that answer. Maybe with that pivot, I'll go to Monica and ask you kind of how do you look at fulfillment and how do you mesh fulfillment in life and your career together?
So thank you for the question. It's given me a couple of days to actually be thinking about what truly like fulfillment in my life has meant. And I think it's been a journey of different things. I've been really fortunate in my career to be able to follow the things that sort of move my heart. So I did international human rights work for much of my career and then moved to local legal services. And now at the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights in 2020, and I've been there, you know, through much of this particular administration, fulfillment is really feeling like I can be of service. I sort of thought I had stepped away from the social justice and human rights work and had a different plan for myself. And, you know, the election happened and Charlottesville happened. And I thought, well, if there was ever a moment to serve, it's right now. And so fulfillment for me is getting up every day and feeling like we cannot just fight for racial justice and equity, but actually dream of a world where I want to raise my kids in and work towards it. And so, you know, that doesn't mean it's easy. I don't think that, I think as I was, for myself and for others that I've talked to, I think early on in our careers, we have this vision of like, we just have to find the perfect job and like purpose and that's gonna be it. And the reality is that it's a journey and we find fulfillment everywhere that we are. And I will say, you know, one of my greatest joys right now is having the team that we have at the Lawyers Committee. I get so much joy out of learning from and watching the team that we have and seeing how much they push themselves, sometimes beyond what I think any of us should push ourselves to do, and to really serve community and serve the clients that we have. And so that's incredibly fulfilling. And I think just personally, you know, it's all about finding the time with the kids. And I for years was saying, I'm just missing out on their childhoods and I need more time with them. And now I have nothing but, you know, they're knocking on the door 2 seconds ago. And we'll be, you know, we've been learning a lot about each other and our kids and spending time together. And it's really, I think fulfillment is really finding those moments, even when the days are hard, to feel like you're aligned in what you get to do and aligned in the people and family and community that you surround yourself with.
Great. Thank you so much. And Abam, would also love to hear from you just what fulfillment means to you and what that looks like for you.
Sure. So I have to say first that I didn't realize Laura was from Minnesota. So that's home for me in the US. So I know all about Minnesota night. Hi, Laura. For me, fulfillment really means bringing my whole self into whether it's work or home. And what I mean by that is someone once said to me that the richest place in the world is the cemetery. And I'm not trying to be grim this beautiful Friday here. But for me, what that meant was there's so much of our inner genius that we take to the grave because we don't actually leverage all our skills and our talents while we're here. So I've thought about that a lot in the years since I heard it. And so for me, fulfillment is really, how do I bring all aspects of my genius to what I do, whether it's at home or it's at work? And so when I talk to my now former team, and when I mentor people, I talk a lot about fulfillment being really bringing all those aspects of you that are your best self into your work, into your community, into your home. And that's why you see for me, I speak and I write because a critical part of fulfillment for me is connecting the dots and connecting people. And so whatever medium I can do that in, whether it's through my legal work, where I focus on issues of social justice sometimes, or in a corporation or inclusion and diversity, I'm forever finding ways to connect people and ideas. And that for me is what fulfillment really is. I think in the first, I would say, 3/4 of my career, I was very focused on being a great lawyer and didn't really know how to bring the other aspects of me into the workplace. And over time, as I thought through, and I thought, my gosh, I'm going to be a lawyer for a long time. I need to be fulfilled. I had to find a way to say, how am I going to bring Abam the mother in? How am I going to bring Abam the friend in, the writer in, the speaker in? And I can say in the last 2.5 years, when I've been able to really consciously do that, I feel much more fulfilled. So for me, it's really, when you think about it in your personal space, it's really about bringing that whole creative, genius self to everything that you do.
Abam, I love that. Can you maybe unpack that a little bit? Because I just this year, after, you know, 8 years of practicing law at age 35, I, for the first time in my life, I feel comfortable enough to do that, to bring myself to work and be who I am. I wish I knew that earlier. So maybe other people relate to this. Like, what are some challenges? How did you overcome your fears? Were there times you were like, oh, I shouldn't bring myself in? And kind of walk us through that. Any practical tips, for example?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I think I've been practicing since 2007. And it's only been in the last 2 years where I've been able to say, you know what? How much of myself am I going to leave at home every morning? So in very practical terms, the first thing was a real conversation with me, which was, how long are you going to be doing this, which is bifurcating your life? It doesn't make sense. And so I realized, too, that when I would get my performance reviews, everything would be great, but it'd always be something there about, we can't really access you. There's something about you that there's a wall up somewhere, and people can feel that. And I didn't start to have that until I had a team, right? So they saw one version of me, which was not the whole version, and that was very clear. So I think the first thing you do is have a conversation with yourself, is what I did, to say, why am I not telling my colleagues that I love to write and I do write? And, you know, if I have something published, why am I not telling them that I'm a poet? Why am I not telling them? I sit and hear about everybody else's everything. Why am I not willing to do that? So I think it's just having that conversation with yourself and getting comfortable with what you want to share versus not. The second thing I would say is after that conversation, then you have to think about your organization, right? Not all companies want you to be out there being multiple things, because you can always be tied back to your company, and so your actions, people will attribute to your company. The thing is understanding your company culture and organization and saying, the thing I want to do, does it match? And if it doesn't match, maybe I don't need to blend those two things, right? But if there, I have been lucky in that GSK's values and my personal values are very aligned. And so once you figure that out, I think the third step is going ahead and having that conversation with your line management and just saying, okay, you know, clearing conflicts of interest. Well, lawyers, after all, we have to follow the rules. Clearing conflicts of interest, making sure that whatever you're doing does not conflict with your company's mission, and so on and so forth. But I think it's really, it has to be very intentional to ensure that you're not compromising work, but you're also not compromising yourself.
That's a wonderful point. Thank you. I think it reminds me of Laura, something Laura said, and we talked about earlier. Laura, when did you have that conversation with yourself? And then for the second part, which was having the conversation with the organization, we're both blessed to be part of the Clorox company where I don't feel that tension at all. But maybe for that part, are there things you did to contribute or you do on a daily basis to contribute to making that sort of environment?
Great question. And Vama, thank you so much for sharing your thoughts. I'm still loving the genius, bringing out our genius. I love that comment. You know, and maybe it is part of the Minnesota tradition, but I think about my grandpa Holton, who, you know, whoever he'd be talking to, whether he'd be talking to the President of the United States or whether he'd be talking to someone, you know, who had, you know, kind of one of the lowest paying jobs or was even more vulnerable than that. And everybody found interest and value and treated and talked to people. So I love people. So, you know, in terms of, I like talking to people and I'm pretty transparent and always have been about, you know, what's going on with my kids and other things. You know, so, and I do think, as Obama said, that can come with time. You know, as you become more comfortable with all the you know, all the things that you're trying to do to be a good person, to try to add value, to try to be a good teammate, to try to influence positive change. I think as the years pass, sometimes you realize, you know what, I'm trying my best. And so it may not always turn out the way I'd want, but sometimes you'll learn more from things that don't work out the way you wanted. And so, you know, with that, it just, you just kind of created that, you know, who people see at work is who they see in the neighborhood or with the family. And, but I think as honest as sometimes it's recognizing you should always be that way as opposed to, you know, needing time to get comfortable in you know, that you've got this, because you do have it. You've had it since, you know, you were young. And if you just act, if I try to just act like my grandpa, life is good. And then in terms of fostering an environment, I think, you know, people smell non-authenticity a mile away, right? We all know it. So, you know, trying to be really open and approachable and interested in people, which again, I love everybody's stories and being with people, but the more you create and try to be part of an environment where everybody's valued and it's really cool that we have different interests and do different things. And I sure wish I was a poet, but I love reading, and maybe that's why, because I don't have that genius in me, but I would love to. So I think the more that we get to know each other as people, wherever, in whatever place we're working, and really value everything that everybody brings, it just makes for a much better environment where people hopefully, again, support each other, like to work each together, and then together just, you know, do amazing work.
Thank you so much, Laura, for really unpacking that and adding so many layers onto what Abam had laid out there. All of you spoke about, when you talked about what fulfillment means to you, a component of client and community work, right? Whether that's believing in your clients, access to justice, the moment that we're in terms of the uprising and civil unrest and racial justice, or connecting the dots, right? Building networks. And so Monica, a kind of a two-part question for you. One is, would really love to hear from you what you're seeing as just kind of some top needs around, you know, in the civil rights and access to justice space, because it seems like what we're hearing a lot from law students and our members and our partner organizations is folks want to be involved and do community work and do their part, whether that's through racial justice or what we're seeing out there in the world. But folks are increasingly thinking, like, how do I fit in access to justice or civil rights or racial justice work into my work as a way to be fulfilled and to be active in my community, even if my position may not be full-time in the nonprofit public interest space. And so would kind of love to hear from you, just what are you seeing in terms of some urgent needs? And then how are you seeing law students and attorneys and other folks plug in a way that is, in this moment, kind of interesting and motivating for you? Big question.
I always love that Alika gives the easy questions. No, I'm totally joking. The response to the last few months and the uprisings and quite frankly, 2020 has been really inspiring. I think we've seen people from every sector of the legal field and students wanting to do more. And I think there's a couple ways. The first is to do the work internally, to really, if I often say that in this country, racism is woven into the fabric of every institution. And to really understand what that means, to understand what it's like for me as a South Asian woman who grew up in the East Bay, and, you know, what were my own biases? What did I see growing up? I've been running a civil rights organization for the last few years. I've been doing human rights work my whole life. I am on a learning journey. I am constantly learning from our clients. I am constantly learning from this movement and from the attorneys that we work with and from the clients and the communities that we serve. And so I think that's the first thing to do, is to really go within and understand who we are, where we stand, what is it that we can do to show up in a particular way into whatever opportunity we want. I will say that I think more than any profession, the legal profession holds pro bono work and service as a key sort of foundational pillar of who we are. And so, you know, to meet the need, there are a million different pro bono opportunities to do that. But I think showing up in a particular way is really important. Learning about the systems, we can't dismantle what we don't understand. And I think that how we show up in those is so important. So I think often there's a charity mindset, right? Like, I'm gonna go help these folks that are really struggling. And I have all these great skills to bring, and I've got all the solutions because I've went to law school and I've got all this life experience, and it comes from the best place you can imagine. It's full-hearted. And I think what the opportunity of this moment is to actually look at this completely differently. In the human rights world, we call it a rights-based approach, right? So the person sitting in front of me has a right that's been denied or is not being fully realized. I have a skill or a tool set that I can bring to that because I can offer something to the person. We all know from doing service that service enriches us more than anything that we can do. So we often take away so much more. We learn about an issue that we didn't understand. We learn about ourselves in a way we didn't understand. So it really is this rich opportunity to learn for ourselves in each of these interactions. And then it's, bringing that home with us too and saying, well, you know, it doesn't matter. Not everyone needs to leave their jobs and come work in the civil rights community or in the human rights community. We so desperately need people in every sector of the legal community and beyond to also look around and say, well, you know, I always think of DEI work and inclusion work in just the same way that we've been talking about, which is how do we create environments where people can bring their full selves in, and that we can create communities where people are celebrated and appreciated and understood in a way that doesn't always happen. And so I think there's three levels. Do the work internally, serve in whatever way you can, serve from a sort of partnership focused way, and then look around in the environments that you are and really work to support change within your own institutions and communities that you're a part of. Alika, was that both questions or did I miss one?
Yes, you covered it all. And you summarized the three steps that folks can take to look at access to justice and civil rights work as a component of fulfillment in their career. So thank you for that.
That was lovely. Thank you. I echo that, Monica. I wrote down, so we're gonna circle back to these points. I think it's fantastic discussion. So I wanna leave ample time for Q&A from our audience. So we'll invite Nina and Vita to play us one more tune. As they're playing, everyone, you have a Q&A button at the bottom of your Zoom screen. So if you click on that, it'll bring up a window and then you can submit your questions. So please submit the questions while Nina and Vita play the next tune. And when we come back, we'll get to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ali.
Wonderful. Thank you again. Fantastic. Before we get to Q&A, Nina, I wanted to hear from you because we always ask our musicians kind of their take on the theme too, because it turns out that despite the fact that people have different passions and careers, they actually, a lot of these themes are universal. So Nina, I will ask you, how do you find fulfillment? I know you're a lawyer as your day job, and then you're a musician, and that has always been your passion. So kind of, how do you merge the two and find happiness?
Absolutely. So, you know, for me, my career in law is fulfilling in the sense that it challenges me intellectually, and it pays the bills, and it gives me the space, both mental space and time, to do what I actually really love and would do, you know, without anybody paying me anything, which is play music. And so for me, fulfillment is being able to merge both of those things, to have the intellectual challenge and to have the, you know, rewarding work capabilities and projects and involvement with other people doing really great and wonderful things at Clorox, but, you know, also being able to sign off, honestly, at a certain time. And that is a very conscious choice I made in my career to not pursue the, you know, next brass ring. You know, props to those who do, it's great. But for me, the, you know, perfect merge of the work and life includes both the legal aspects and, you know, all the fun mental gymnastics that come with it. But at the end of the day, being able to come home, play music, meet with friends, put on shows for, you know, people who also enjoy music. So that's what fulfillment is for me.
Great. Thank you so much. We have some really wonderful questions. We'll get through as many of them as possible. And the first question can really be answered by anyone, which is, did you ever feel as an attorney that you had untapped passions that you didn't have the time to explore? And so all of you touched on, you know, learning as a value and something that brings you fulfillment. So how did you fit in time to learn new things and explore your passions?
I can start. I think it's just, I made the decision to do it, plain and simple. You know, there are 24 hours in a day, right? And so how you spend that time is entirely up to you. I think when I was at a law firm, I chose to spend all of the time billing time, and I thought it's gonna get better when I go in-house. And I went in-house and I chose to spend most of the time working on legal stuff. And I moved to South Africa and I thought, okay, now it's a more relaxed environment. So I'm gonna do the same. I'm going to find the time and do it. And I spent all the time still working. And it wasn't until 2 years ago where I said, I'm not getting any younger. And if I don't put these skills to good use, they will leave me, right? So I just made the decision that I was going to just write, and then to hold myself accountable, put stuff out there for publication. And so once you do that, you built in a system then that forces you in a way to continue to do that. Same thing with the podcast. Once I committed to the world that I was going to put a podcast out every week, I kind of had to do it. And so I think it always starts with you and saying, I'm going to find that 1 hour or 2 hours in the week and just do this thing that I love, whether it's cooking, it's writing, it's biking. You just have to decide to do it and then find a way to hold yourself accountable to actually see that through to the end. So that's what worked for me.
Great. And I think, Abam, your comments just make so much sense. You know, life is so short that, and there's so many awesome things to do and explore and learn that, you know, for me, I've been really feel very privileged to be in a position where I like to work hard. I really like what I do. And I've got so many other interests and passions as well, and been able to try to integrate those with my with my work. So, you know, I've lived in Asia a few times, lived in Europe a few times, and absolutely, absolutely love to travel. You know, so that's one of the hardest things about the pandemic is not being able to do that, but have been able to wherever my work takes me or wherever I'll figure out how to go, and my family's right there with me and you know, very short notice, you know, we'll travel anywhere, that, you know, you kind of integrate it. So if you're on a work trip, you can find a way to see your friends that you miss, and you know, just feel every moment. And then for me, I've always been just, I don't call it compartmentalizing. I just try whatever I'm doing, whatever I'm focused on, you know, kind of just be here now, focus on the moment and enjoy the moment, because it'll pass. And then so many people have given me great advice through the years. And it's one I love that I actually had heard from, you know, Mary Robinson, the former president of Ireland, said, you know, hey, there's some, you know, we've all got these balls, we've got passions, we've got interests, and just knowing which ones are the crystal ones that, you know, when they drop, you can't put them back together. So realizing, you know, if again, you're trying hard, trying to add value, make a difference, be kind, be good, and then really focus on the things that you really, that mean the most to you, and then make sure you make time for that.
Thank you, Laura. Maybe I'll segue into our next question. And Monica would love to hear your thoughts on this. Oh, wait, this is a fantastic question. It says, with the theme of fulfillment, what has been your compass throughout your career? Who are some people you've kept in your corner? How have you known that what you're doing is fulfilling? What emotions or feelings have you kept in mind as you're going through? I think it's a wonderful question.
I love that question. You know, we all need a centering compass to make sure that our days are spent in a way that feels aligned with who we are as beings. And so I think for me, it's really a couple of things. I think early on, I would say I sort of followed the heartbreak, the things that I couldn't get out of my head that stayed with me, moved me. When I was a law student, I studied abroad one summer, and literally everyone I met had somehow touched Rwanda. And I just couldn't move past it. And so the next summer, I was a law clerk at the Rwanda Tribunal. And from there, I met a young girl whose father was had survived the genocide days away from dying of AIDS. And she sat in my lap the whole time. And I thought, this doesn't make sense to me. Like it stayed very heavily in my heart. And so I ultimately went to work on the right to health and the AIDS pandemic in Haiti and sort of switched careers at some point. And I think the centering thing is to know also that, you know, I think after spending much of my life sort of thinking heartbreak and making sure we fight for dignity, there's another possibility of like, how do we create a world in which every person gets to live out their dreams? And so, you know, I think each of us has a journey and we just have to listen to it and to stay, you know, find ways to, you know, whether you meditate or run or work out or whatever, to get to that really still place where you know what's going to guide you. And I think the other thing to know is that something can really move you for a period of time and it can feel fulfilling, and then it's not. And we hear that as loud and as clear as we do the thing that got us there in the first place. And then we have ego and other things that keep us there. I mean, I will tell you, when I left human rights work, I knew for a good year and a half that it was time. It was too traumatic. I was going to really dangerous places. I had decided to have kids and I had a 2-year-old at home. And it was like thing after thing after thing that kept telling me, it's time to go. And I was like, but I'm a human rights lawyer and I'm gonna do this and that. And ultimately, you know, I learned my lesson, both physically and emotionally. And it was a really tough moment of, now I look back and I was like, well, there were signs so all along the way. And it came to a point where I had no other choice but to walk away. And we don't have to do that. We just have to really trust ourselves and know ourselves and get to the quiet place where it's really clear where we're supposed to go and when we're not supposed to stay.
Thank you so much for that, Monica. Just grounding ourselves in how to get still and listen to your compass and just the different places that can take you and how to be honest with yourself about what's fulfilling and what's not fulfilling and kind of moving through those spaces. So I think we have time for one more question, and we would just love to hear from all of you. You know, just going back to this question about work-life balance, right? It came up in the poll. Each of you have touched on it. You've talked about just making time and those pieces. And, you know, I think all of our audience is hungry for a little bit more of that, right? So just really, how do you like practically create balance for yourself? Abam, I know you mentioned you just did it, right? Like you just created time, but if folks can kind of just touch on how you created time for your balance in a way that contributes to your fulfillment.
I think people are not gonna like to hear this, but, and I didn't like to hear it, but I've gotten away from the assumption that there's such a thing as balance in the traditional way in which we think about it. So when I step back and I think before the pandemic, 50% of my time was spent either flying or going through an airport or in another country. How do you find balance, right? So for me, I think the first thing I had to do was redefine what I meant by balance. Was it balance in terms of time, hours of the day? Or was it in terms of output? So for me, that was the first step. Once I got away from crucifying myself time and time again, because I didn't have 20% with my son and 20%, you know, cooking and 40% at work, I was free then to rethink what I meant by balance. And ultimately what balance meant to me was giving to each person or to each space what it required of me, baseline. And then what was left, I then said, where can I give more? And so it always ended up being, you have to cover the bases. I think that's really important. I need to spend quality time with my son. I need to give to GSK then what he needed for me because it was paying me to do a job. And what is left after that then? I have to be smart about how I spend that time. If it's going to be PTA week, I'm going to spend more time at school. If I have a huge investigation going on, it's going to be a period of time where I spend more late hours at work. And so giving myself permission to be fluid is how I've really kind of managed it. I don't think there's a magic stick. I don't think balance in terms of just hours of the day is going to do it. It's what's crucial at what time and making sure that you've got the bases covered. And the last thing I would say around bases covered is it doesn't always have to be you that's covering the bases. I think as mothers, many of us just crucify ourselves when we're not the ones covering the bases. Well, then why do you have a partner? And in my case, where I don't have a partner, I have a nanny. Why do you have that, right? If there are resources that can support you, from time to time, you need to leverage them to cover the bases. At work, why do you have a team? So I think we need to rethink what balance means and for individual situations, work out how we map that out so that we're covering the bases. And we're also then giving to each project or each space or each person in our life what they need at different points.
I love that, Abam. So again, continue to learn from you and Monica and Alika and Ali and Mina and Vita in this program. For me, I'd say just a couple things, you know, that's really important to me is one, you know, what's my, you know, attitude. So I find balance based on what's going on in my head. And is, you know, do I feel, because I can be busier than I've ever been and feel more balanced if I feel fulfilled and I love what I'm doing. And so some of the things I try to do is always, you know, frame things for myself, like, and try to put things in perspective. And so, you know, Monica spoke of doing International Tribunal human rights work in Rwanda. And I was privileged to go to Rwanda a couple of years ago and go to that genocide museum. And I'm still raw from it. But, you know, so when I think about putting stuff into perspective, I think about, you know, just how fortunate I am, how privileged I am, and, you know, this too shall pass. And if people have basic human rights and they have health and they have, you know, food and the opportunity for fair housing and employment, like, you know, that's just, it's so fortunate. So a lot of it for me is always, whenever I start to feel out of balance, to just realize I have a choice. I have a choice, and I choose how I spend my time. I choose what I do. I choose it. And, you know, and trying to really take a step back and realize, like, this is so cool that I get to do this, that I, you know, get to have a wonderful family, that I get to be involved in trying to make my communities better, that I get to be part of an amazing team trying to do good work. And so for me, it's so much of how I frame things and how I think about things. And that helps a lot. And then the other thing that's really key for me is I want to live a life with no regret. I really, you know, life is short, and I want to spend that time with my kids and my family. And I want to go to do whatever it is that we want to do. I, you know, go walking every day with friends. I'm loving birds in my backyard. I love sports and music concerts. And so I've got to find a way to do things in my other aspects of life so I can do that with my family, because I don't want to have any regrets. So like, for me, it's kind of attitude and no regrets, and I'm in control. I make my choices, and hopefully I do so in a way that, you know, tries to be positive, a force for good.
I think I so love what both of you have said, and I think I often talk to folks who are earlier in their careers, and I say exactly, there is no balance. Like, there's no perfect formula of family and work. And there, and we have, you know, hopefully long lives and careers. And I think there are different times where certain things take priority. And so when I moved to California in August of 2016, I had a vision of my life of spending more time with my kids and consulting and coaching and doing all these things. And then the election came, and my husband was traveling 80% of the time. And there was just this pull to come into this work. And so we had to step back and say, our kids will get less of us. And we are making that decision because it is really important in who we are and what we believe in, that we as a family are committing to doing this work in this way, which will be emotionally draining and time draining and hard, and it may or may not work. I mean, our hope is that our kids will see that and at some point in their lives learn from that, or we'll be paying for therapy forever. I mean, who knows what this is going to look like, but we made that, we had a really conscious, thoughtful conversation around that. And I think the other thing, especially because many of us who have partners, we both have really intense careers, and I think there's a balance there too of, over the course of our partnership, someone's career is going to take more priority and someone's going to take a little bit of a backseat. And sometimes it's both going to be really intense and it's going to have an impact on the family that we've chosen. And so I think it's just being really aware of it. And I think being clear that, particularly for me and for many of you, I'm sure, that are feeling this right now, we feel like we have to do more. And that's the calculation right now. And the best that we can do in that time is to find ways to stay centered and make sure that we can get through everything that we need to do and be there when we're with the kids, even if it's less time that we're there. You know, I felt like I hadn't made dinner in a long time, so I made dinner this afternoon so that the kids are eating, so my family's getting their favorite meal today. Yeah, it happens in moments, and we have to appreciate the moments. And I think, like Laura said, we don't know, particularly right now, I can't tell you how many friends have been calling and reaching out, and we just don't know when our last day is. And there's so many people, we are living in a time where so much is uncertain, and we have to just sort of make it through the day and support each other in the best way that we can as we do that.
Beautiful. Thank you, Monica. One of my favorite quotes I never forget is from Van Gogh. He says, small emotions are the great captains of our lives. And I think, to your point, it's these small moments. So much incredible content today. I tried to distill it to five actionable takeaways for everyone. I'll share this with you, and then Nina and Vita will play our final song and we'll say goodbye. Number one, love people. This is the point Laura made. People approach everyone with curiosity, with really authentically trying to find their values and who they are and caring for them. So love people always. Number two, giving. I just learned this year myself. I think there's a misconception that giving or charity or volunteering takes energy, that you have to make time for it after a long day of work and you're already tired. But I found the opposite. Giving actually produces energy. And so I invite all of you to try to give, to volunteer in the partnership model that Monica mentioned. It'll expand your network. It will fulfill you. It'll give you more energy. It will help you discover what your values are and things that are important to you. Number three, I'd written down find your compass, but as the conversation went on, I struck find and I said follow your compasses, because Monica, Obama, Laura all pointed out that our values change, our compasses change. And so listening to ourselves of what's important to us at any moment is as important as finding what's important prior. Number four, this is Laura's image, juggle the crystal balls. So we all have many, many balls. Some are crystal balls that if they fall, they will shatter. The one that comes to my mind is treating your partner or your loved ones with respect and never crossing that line. Because once hearts are broken, it's hard to mend them. So love that image. And number five, this is Abam's. Fulfillment is not finding the perfect balance or finding the perfect job that you love doing every day. Fulfillment is learning to find things in a balance or misbalance or in a job that you may not necessarily love all the time, but finding the things that you do love, the people you love working with, and tying it back to what Laura started with, the formula of interesting work, caring teammates, and good purpose. Fulfillment is finding little emotions in those three things that fulfill you. What a wonderful program. Thank all of you for joining. Please stay on to listen to the amazing goodbye song, and then we'll all wave goodbye. And thank you for joining us for the Summer 6 series. Nina, Vita, please.
Thanks, Ellie.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Nina and Vita. Thank you, our panelists. Thank you, our guests. Thank you all. Goodbye.